This is a quagga. With its brown and white stripes, mainly in the front part of its body, it is easily distinguishable from the zebras as we know them. And these are the only photos in the world of a living quagga, all showing the same animal in a zoo in London. As its distribution in southern Africa was very limited and it was easy to find and kill, it became vulnerable to extinction ever since Dutch colonists settled in South Africa, who started hunting them for their meat or for their skin. Around 1850, the quagga herds were almost completely gone. Yet due to a naming confusion, most of the people did not realize that the species was critically endangered. Local people referred to all types of zebra as quagga, and so when in 1883 the last known quagga died in the zoo of Amsterdam, they simply requested a new one, believing there are still ones out there. In the year 1900, its extinction was internationally accepted, and it was believed to have joined the many species with no chance of ever returning. But now, more than a century later, the quagga is back. The variety of species on Earth is so tremendous because of a constant speciation that is happening, of populations evolving to become new distinct species. Parallel to that, there are animal extinctions, which generally also are a normal part of the evolutionary process. The background extinction rate is a measurement of how many of them occur. These processes are slow, and so scientists look at periods from several centuries up to several millions of years and look for eras where particularly strong and quick rashes can be seen. In the history of life on Earth, there have been a few mass extinction events where 70 to 90% of all species were killed off. And some scientists argue that we are currently in the midst of the sixth mass extinction event, the Holocene extinction. The rate of global species extinctions is estimated to be somewhere between 1,000 to 10,000 times higher than the average background extinction rates, and this is caused to massive extent by humans. This becomes a big problem in the oceans, where overfishing of one species can upset entire ecosystems. Results of overexploitation are also seen in the charismatic megafauna. So elephants get shot for their tusks, tigers skin for their pelts, and rhinoceros shot for their horns. Just recently, the death of Sudan made headlines. He was the last northern white male rhino, and with his death, the subspecies is pretty much doomed to end. Rhinos are poached for their horns, which are sold mainly to Vietnam and China, where they are used for traditional medicine practices that lack any scientific or medical validity. Another reason for the increased extinction rates is the destruction of natural habitats by humans. Particularly in rainforests that are cut down for wood or converted into oil palms, soybean, or coffee plantations. And then there is global warming, which threatens those species the most that are highly specialized. At this stage, especially animals living near the Earth's poles or in the oceans are affected the most. Even slight climatic changes can have a huge impact on entire ecosystems. But some do not want to accept the disappearance of such animals, and so there are different efforts to reverse extinction. Above all, there is cloning technology that has been advancing for decades. Cloning succeeded for the first time with Dolly the sheep in 1996. Since then, countless of animals of different kinds were cloned. Here is a very basic explanation of what happens there. In reproductive cloning, the nucleus of an animal's body cell, which contains the DNA, is removed. The same is done with an unfertilized egg cell from a donor. After this separation is done, the nucleus is placed in the egg cell. To do this, scientists put various chemicals on the cell and give it an electric shock, which fuses nucleus and egg cell. And that embryo is then delivered by a surrogate mother. That way, a genetically identical living being can be produced. The number of organisms actually born, as compared to the total number of cells that went through the nucleus transfer, is low, and the error rate is high. However, the research continues to evolve and get better. And many speculate on this success. For example, since 1976, a stowage facility located in the San Diego Zoo keeps DNA samples of the most rare and endangered species worldwide stored. The probes in facilities like this frozen zoo could be used in the future for cloning dead species back to life. Candidates of animals that one day could eventually be cloned include the woolly mammoth, the North American passenger pigeon, or the bucardo, a Spanish wild goat. In case of the bucardo, scientists realized early on that its extinction could not be prevented due to the quick decline in their population. That's why in 1999 they caught the last bucardo female, named Celia, and took tissue samples from her ear. Just 1 year later, Celia died and the species was declared extinct. But scientists took the DNA from the probe of her ear and planted it as a cloned egg in a goat, which gave birth to a baby bucardo. It was the first successful de-extinction, yet the animal died after just 10 minutes due to a lung defect. But still, it proved that de-extinction is possible, and with cloning techniques advancing and becoming more reliable, bringing an entire population of an extinct species back to life may one day be possible. There's also a fundamentally different approach in bringing deceased species back to life, through a process that humans have known for thousands of years, selective breeding. Apart from the common goal of bringing a deceased species back to life, the two methods are completely different. Cloning creates an actual genetic member of the original species. You can think of it almost like an identical copy of an animal. In selective breeding, on the other hand, you breed a species to be as close as possible to the original. That species then resembles the original that went extinct, but how close those two really are is hard to say. The Quagga Project is probably the most comprehensive attempt so far at using selective breeding to recreate an extinct species. All of this began in the late 60s, when Reinhold Rau, a German natural historian, became interested in the quagga and traveled around Europe studying quagga specimens in museums. He was inspired by the idea of bringing the extinct species back to life, however he found little support for his project. Quaggas had been its own species and therefore it was believed that the genetic material of other remaining zebras was just not suitable for breeding quaggas. During that time, he worked as a taxidermist at the South African Museum in Cape Town, where a stuffed quagga foal was displayed. It had been badly preserved and therefore he went to repair it. He discovered that the skin of the animal still contained well-preserved remains, suitable for scientific investigations. It took more than a decade, but in the early 80s, newly developed genetic techniques made it possible to extract DNA from the probes Rau had stored. The quagga's DNA was analyzed and compared with that of other zebras. And as it turns out, the DNA matched with that of the plain zebra. Which means that the quagga never was its own species, but a southern population of the still existing zebras. A subspecies genetically almost identical, but with different appearance. Reinhold Rau used those results as justification for a selective breeding program, the Quagga Project. For that, they developed a very clear system. All animals are photographed from both sides. Then they look at five separate body areas where they count the number of stripes. The background color is determined on a scale from dark brown to white. Using this method, they were able to get each successive generation to closer resemble the original quaggas. And already the reduced stripe pattern is very apparent, whereas the darker background color is a trait more difficult to breed back. There are also critics to the project. Some see it as a stunt that gives us the feeling of repairing something while actually having no impact on the conservation of biodiversity on this planet. The human factor plays a significant role in determining what defines a quagga in this project. While scientists focus on appearance, it is completely unknown what behavioral traits the original quaggas had. That is why the bred animals are called Rau quaggas, to account for those differences. And this harsh reality, that the newly bred quaggas will never truly be the same, may help us understand how fundamental it is to save those species from extinction that are currently threatened the most. If you want to support more documentaries like this, then please subscribe and share this video. If you're wondering why the channel has a new name, there is info about that in the video description. Thanks for watching.